What's going on, guys? This is Rob, and if you're enjoying the content that I'm uploading onto my channel, then feel free to subscribe, and you can also offer suggestions on topics and characters and storylines and whatnot that we can have discussions on later on in this channel. So continuing our coverage of World War Hulk, in this video, we're going to focus on the Incredible Hulk fighting all the X-Men. And when I say all the X-Men, I mean all the X-Men, every last one. Now, this is actually a really, really, really cool set of events. So the reason why is because it's just the Hulk fighting every single X-Men. How does it get cooler than that? The issue with this is that this story, as far as I've been able to tell, is a little ambiguous on where it stands. Of course, we know that it's around the time that the Incredible Hulk shows up on Earth, but we don't know if it is before he fights Tony Stark, if it's after he fights Tony Stark. At least I haven't been able to figure that out yet. But it happens around the first issue, so that's really good enough. Besides, it's just the Incredible Hulk beating up X-Men. We can just kind of guess when it takes place. But what this does is this initially picks up with Tony Stark meeting with Charles Xavier prior to his conflict with the Incredible Hulk in the first issue. Now, the kicker to this is that Charles Xavier was not present during the events of the Illuminati kicking Bruce Banner off the face of the planet Earth and sending him off to the events that would lead into Planet Hulk. Instead, this was after the events of House of M. And so, you know, at this point in time, Charles Xavier was still missing in action. No one really knew where he was. And so because he wasn't part of these events, he never made a conscious decision. Now, initially, Tony Stark asked him this. Tony Stark says, hey, man, look, like, here's what's going on. Like, I'm just going to brief you because you're part of the Illuminati. You need to know what's going on. But his other question is, if you had to have made a choice, if you had to have chosen whether or not to banish the Hulk, which choice would you have made? Now, Charles Xavier doesn't initially answer him. Instead, we just basically pick up with the present day. Now, what this does, or at least what this opening tie-in does, initially, at least by Christos Gage, the way that he does it, is it just focuses largely on Charles Xavier just kind of reminding us, or at the very least Christos Gage reminding us, where things stand in the mutant community. Now, on the surface, this wouldn't really seem necessary, but a comic book that basically centers on the Incredible Hulk fighting the X-Men would draw attention no matter where people were in the realm of their understanding of comics. And so the great thing about this is that it almost treats it like a self-contained story to a degree, in the sense that it refreshes people with where the X-Men are at if they haven't read anything about the X-Men up to this point. Now again, after the events of House of M, we know that the Scarlet Witch's actions were on a multiversal level, in the sense that she had stripped 98% of the mutant population of their powers across the multiverse, not just the main Marvel universe. And so because of this, after the events of House of M, there were no mutants being born. This is the reason why the birth of Hope Summers was such a big deal in the Marvel timeline, because we'd never seen any new mutants being born after House of M. Instead, there was just a massive reduction, and then the number just seemed to stop there. And so again, you know, with the idea of the mutant population being reduced down to 198 in total, plus a few who have died here and there over the course of the events between House of M and this and World War Hulk right now, this is really just a scenario where they're all being not really held prisoner, but they're all being guarded by sentinels within the confines of the Xavier Mansion. However, almost immediately after we pick up with this little bit of a story, we suddenly have, you know, the Incredible Hulk showing up in front of Xavier Mansion. Now, the first thing he says is, I want Charles Xavier. Like, I want Charles Xavier out here right now. You know, I want him. I want to talk to him. Now, we're actually going to learn the Incredible Hulk doesn't intend to kill Charles Xavier or even to beat him extremely bad. Instead, like, he's showing up here because he has questions that he wants answered. But the kicker is that, you know, you have the sub roster, like the minor X-Men that honestly most people don't really care about, you know, who are here right now, and they're the ones that are just kind of hanging out, you know, with Charles Xavier. But Beast tells him, look, man, you got to get out of here. Like, we cannot bring you Charles Xavier. That's not gonna happen. Now, this is actually pretty important because Beast has a long-standing history with the Incredible Hulk. I wouldn't go as far as to say that they're like the best of friends ever, but there is a lot of respect between the two of them because Bruce Banner's a scientist, Beast is a scientist. They share a common ground in terms of their overall interests and views, and there's been a multitude of times where they've reached across the aisle and talked to one another in order to sort out various problems that they couldn't do on their own. The problem with this is that the Incredible Hulk has no interest in past friendships. The Incredible Hulk has no interest in past allies. Instead, he just simply sends Hank McCoy flying along his way and almost knocks him out. In response to this, the X-Men essentially jump in as best they can. Now, somebody else who's kind of sitting on the sidelines here is Joshua Foley. Now, Joshua Foley is an Omega-level mutant. He's really, really powerful within the confines of his abilities. The problem is that his abilities are not in the realm of, you know, telekinesis or telepathy. You know, he's not an omega level energy projector or anything like that. He's a kid that can basically control the biological structure of other people's bodies, but only insofar as how it's confined to healing. So he can heal from anything and he can heal others from anything. He's effectively immortal. The issue with this is that the plan of Beast is to basically send the healing factor of the Incredible Hulk into overdrive. But the reason why I say this is an issue is because the Incredible Hulk is an uncharted levels of power here, even for his character. The X-Men have never faced a foe on the level of Incredible Hulk when it comes to sheer strength and durability. They've faced wildly powerful beings, but we're talking about beings with the ability to warp reality, stuff like that. But the Incredible Hulk is a tangible threat that cannot be stopped. The closest that we ever really got to the X-Men associating with someone like this would be like Eighth Day Juggernaut. But Eighth Day Juggernaut, that's something we'll talk about here in a little bit when the Juggernaut shows up. But Eighth Day Juggernaut was not on the same level as Worldbreaker Hulk. They were close, but Eighth Day Juggernaut would probably still be defeated by Worldbreaker Hulk. It actually creates a pretty cool discussion, a pretty cool debate. Eighth Day Juggernaut. I'm curious, who do you think would win? Eighth Day Juggernaut or the Incredible Hulk? I'll run over what Eighth Day Juggernaut is here in a minute. But for right now, it's really just these X-Men doing what they can to face off against the Hulk. But in truth, I mean, this is the B roster. You know, these guys have no chance. Now, the cool thing here is we actually get to see Laura Kinney fight. Now, Laura Kinney, of course, X-23, I have a character, I have videos on her. For those of you guys who don't know, X-23 was cloned or designed to be a clone of Wolverine, but they had to modify her genes to make her a woman instead of a guy simply because of the fact that the chromosomes used to create her were corrupted to a degree, and so they were just kind of stuck with making her a female. But she's every ounce as capable as Wolverine is in the sense that she has adamantium claws, in the sense that she is a prodigious fighter. She was trained to be an assassin. She has enhanced healing, all the same features as Wolverine. It's just a different characteristic of her in terms of who she is, and the backstory is different. But the idea here is that while she does have the same kind of fighting ability as Wolverine, she doesn't have the same experience. And that's what makes a whole different thing. Now, she is capable because she's assassinated people, she's been in a lot of different conflicts, but she's never gone toe-to-toe with the Incredible Hulk. Wolverine has. Logan has gone against the Incredible Hulk in a multitude of occasions, and so he knows how to engage the Hulk effectively. And this proves itself in the fact that X-23 has no chance here. I mean, she has adamantium, she manages to scrape his face, but the Incredible Hulk grabs her and just throws her into a wall, and that's that. You know, she has nothing to offer in this situation. So again, from here, it's really just the Incredible Hulk turning his attention to everyone he can find until we get the A roster of the X-Men showing up. And this is Wolverine, this is Cyclops, Emma Frost, Colossus, Kitty Pryde. Colossus is actually a really cool situation in this fight too. It's really, really funny what happens. I mean, it's not funny what happens to him, but it's kind of funny. It's kind of funny. Like, it's cool. But the idea here is that Charles Xavier says, okay, fine. You know, look, the Incredible Hulk didn't show up here for no reason. All right, it's not like he's just on a rampage. You know, we know he's demanding members of the Illuminati. Again, the X-Men don't know about the Illuminati, but in the mind of Charles Xavier, he's like, he's demanding my fellow members of the Illuminati. It has something to do with what they made. This, combined with what it was that Tony Stark told me, indicates the Incredible Hulk has come back here to unleash hell on us all. He's come back here to destroy us as the Illuminati. And so what we do here is we transition with Charles Xavier as he goes through and begins scanning the mind of the Incredible Hulk. Now, what's funny about this is Charles Xavier tells us that in years past, it's never been insanely difficult to scan the mind of the Incredible Hulk. It was always relatively difficult because the Hulk's mind was really more of a primal force, more so than inaccessible or something like that. But the idea here is that the Incredible Hulk is filled with so much rage right now that it's almost created its own self-sustaining barrier against the powers of Charles Xavier. He is able to penetrate, but when he does, he finds the source of this anger. He finds out the Incredible Hulk had effectively been tortured, been forced into combat as a gladiator. He had found love and then lost love, and all of that happened because of the actions of the Illuminati. And so Charles Xavier is kind of in a situation right here where he's like, there's nothing we can do to stop him right now. Like, he's not going to be able to listen to reason. More so than that, what Charles Xavier saw was projected into the minds of all the other X-Men as Charles Xavier was seeing it. And so it's not like the X-Men don't know why the Hulk is here now. They all understand why he's here. But the idea is that they've essentially come to the realization that there's no talking sense to the Incredible Hulk right now. The Incredible Hulk is in a state of absolute madness. He's almost feral in terms of how angry he is. And he's in a level of uncharted strength and durability here. And so while the other X-Men are temporarily incapacitated, he asks Charles Xavier the most important question. He says, you know, look, I know that you were not part of the Illuminati when I was banished from this world. I know that, you know, from what Black Bolt told me, you're not here. He doesn't know everything about House of of M, but he knows that Charles Xavier was not here when that happened. But he asked the question, if you had to make a choice, if you had to, you know, vote, how would you have voted? Would you have kicked me out, or would you have kept me here on the planet Earth? Now, Charles Xavier does provide a definitive answer here. He beats around the bush for a little bit. You know, he kind of toys around for a little bit, but he says, look, I would not have agreed to kicking you out of Earth for eternity. I would not have forced you to leave. What I would have done is I would have said, we need to remove you from the Earth until we can find a cure. The problem with this for the Incredible Hulk is that there's no real difference here. Whether it was Charles Xavier, you know, banishing him or exiling him until they could find a cure or exiling him forever, it's all the same thing. And the reason why we know this is because Charles Xavier says, look, fine, if you want to take me, you can take me. I will go with you. I will effectively give up. I will surrender. And the Hulk says, cool, let's go. But you know, of course, Colossus and the other X-Men step in and they say, no, you're not taking Charles Xavier anywhere. Now, we know with the X-Men, they have a massive amount of respect for Charles Xavier, but this is that in-between period. This is that period where the line of X-Men publications are starting to see Cyclops begin to break away from the teachings of Charles Xavier and start to leave him behind. Now, all of that really came to a head in Avengers versus X-Men, but the idea is that this is kind of the rift being formed. This is Cyclops beginning to look away from the idea of Charles Xavier, moving away from his teachings, and ultimately stepping into his own as the de facto leader of the X-Men for the most part. Now, of course, with the other X-Men stepping in and doing what they can, I mean, they put up one hell of a fight. I mean, you have Cyclops using the full blast of his optic blast. You have Wolverine, who uses his claws as best he can, you know, of course, to try to fight off the Incredible Hulk here, but none of them are really able to do anything to hold their own. Emma Frost even goes as far as to say, hey, look, I'm joining the fight here. You know, my daughters, you know, my clones, more or less, the Stepford Cuckoos, are monitoring the entire fight. And so if you try to step in and stop us from fighting, we'll shut your mind down. And so it's really her saying, go in and tend to the wounded. Do not get in the way. Now, again, this is, of course, you know, just the idea that they're breaking away. I mean, again, you know, after the events of House of M, during the Decimation storyline, when Charles Xavier was absentee, it was really left to Emma Frost and to Cyclops to run the X-Men team. And so in their mind, Charles Xavier is now an unessential part of the X-Men roster. They've really proven they can run it without him. They don't really need him. His return is welcomed, but his return is also somewhat inconvenient for Emma and Cyclops in the sense that, again, they don't feel like they need him. And this is just really Marvel continuing this trend of the X-Men, or at least of Emma Frost and Cyclops, saying, look, it's cool that you're here, but you're just kind of getting in the way at this point because all you can do is use telepathy and you've essentially already given up. So you're really more of a hindrance. You know, it's essentially one of those things where, you know, it's like, if you're not part of the solution, you're part of the problem. And so they basically send Charles Xavier back into the mansion, which is really wild to see some measure of respect given here, but to also see a vast amount of disrespect to the guy that literally laid the groundwork for what the X-Men would become in terms of Marvel Comics. But at the very least, you know, because of the story as it goes right now, I mean, this is really kind of a necessity too, because with Charles Xavier having telepathy, there's really not a whole lot he can do. I mean, Emma Frost wouldn't even be part of this conflict if she didn't have a secondary mutation that allowed her to take on her diamond form. But because she has this, I mean, she can step in and she has, you know, a reasonable measure of durability against the Incredible Hulk. But at the end of the day, I mean, she's not strong enough to put up a legitimate fight and take the Incredible Hulk out. Now, from here, we actually pick up with Kitty Pryde. And Kitty Pryde is actually really interesting in this situation because normally we wouldn't consider her to be an essential part of the story. We would kind of laugh it off and say, well, you know, it's Kitty Pryde, whatever. But what she does is she phases the Incredible Hulk into the ground. Now, as we know with the Incredible Hulk, his strength, you know, just increases the angrier he gets. And so this is really more of a stopgap measure. And in fact, even, you know, Beast says, yeah, this is really cool, but this is also a stopgap measure. We have to find something that we need to do. I mean, we got to find something to do with him. Now, they initially toy with the idea of throwing him in the prison and the negative zone, because remember, during the events of Civil War, Reed Richards and Hank Pym and Tony Stark built Prison 42. They built the prison in the negative zone to house those superheroes who refused to register with the Superhuman Registration Act. And they initially consider throwing the Incredible Hulk in there, because if they put him in there and they close the portal, he'll never be able to get back out. Like, he'll literally just be stuck in the negative zone. But the result is that as they're in the middle of having this discussion, he suddenly breaks himself free. Now, at this point, is really the X-Men sending out an SOS. I mean, you have the younger mutants watching all these events unfold. You have, you know, the Stepford Cuckoos who are watching everything happen. And the idea here is, okay, look, the X-Men can't do this on their own. Like, we've seen the X-Men cannot deal with the Incredible Hulk in this level of rage. And so what they do is they send out a message to everybody, to Jamie Madrox and the X-Factor investigations, to Siren, the daughter, I think it is, of Banshee, who has like this scream that can can disorient people and allow her to fly. They send it out to anybody who's listening, anyone, you know, Excalibur, anybody who is listening to this, or at the very least is aware or familiar with the X-Men, the message goes out to them all. Now, Excalibur doesn't initially step in. You know, Captain Britain, Dazzler, they kind of stay behind. But we end up having the Juggernaut, who actually takes his Crimson Gem of Sidorak and communes directly with Sidorak himself. Now, again, we'll get a little more into what this means in terms of the sort of, repowering of the Juggernaut, in terms of Kane Marco, how he normally functions versus a full amount, or at least a strong amount of the power of Sidorak. But the idea is that while this is happening, the X-Men are just kind of buying time. The X-Men are doing the best they can. Now, Hulk turns his sights to Emma Frost and he says, "You're in a tough situation here." And the reason why is because you can't use your telepathy while you're in your diamond form. And in order to use your telepathy, you have to leave your diamond form. But if you do, I have a hold of you, which means that if you get out of your diamond form, I'm going to destroy you. And so it's just this funny scenario. Now, in truth, the Incredible Hulk could probably crush her in her diamond form right now with him being as strong as he is. But before he's able to do any one of those things, we have Colossus stepping in. Now, this is why I say things get so cool with Colossus, because historically, Colossus has never been like equal with the Incredible Hulk in terms of power. And the Incredible Hulk's baseline form, sure, but the Incredible Hulk just keeps getting stronger. You know, Colossus does not have an infinite level of strength. He turns into his organic metal form and he's as strong as he's gonna get. You know, he doesn't get any stronger than where he is in this form right now. Now, he goes against the Incredible Hulk, and the Incredible Hulk even goes as far as to say, "Hey man, there was probably a time when you were my equal. There was probably a time when for a little while you would have been able to hold your own against me." He's like, "But right now you don't have a chance, my friend." And he actually breaks the arms of Colossus in his organic metal form. Now, the reason why this is a big deal is because rarely have we ever seen anybody physically harm Colossus in his organic metal form. In truth, the only people who have been able to do that, or who could do that, are of course the Incredible Hulk in this situation, Magneto, who can control metal, Polaris, Magneto's daughter, who can control metal. And, you know, aside from that, that's really it. You know, I mean, you know, you have like you have Wolverine's adamantium, which could probably cut through Colossus, but we've never really had a reason, aside from, you know, some what if story somewhere where Wolverine kills the Marvel Universe, we've never really had a reason to ask the question of whether or not Wolverine could puncture Colossus' organic metal skin. But the idea is that Wolverine effectively jumps back into the fray and begins going against the Incredible Hulk again. Now, here's the other half of this equation when it comes to the Hulk going against Wolverine. In almost all of their previous conflicts, Wolverine was always the smarter guy. You know, the Hulk in their previous engagements was just raging. He was a guy who was, you know, he was going aggro on Wolverine. You know, he was literally just fighting and fighting and punching and punching, but never really thinking about what was going on. Whereas Wolverine was usually able to outpace him. He was able to dance around him. He was able to get past him, whatever it is he needed to do. With the Incredible Hulk in this situation right now, he's a thinking machine. I mean, he's a guy that's got the full faculties of his normal self. He's able to think on, you know, a normal way than he usually is. And so because of this, he asked the question, "Well, if I can't break your, you know, adamantium skeleton, if I can't destroy that, inside your adamantium skeleton are the same fluids and the same marrows as a normal person has." But he says the adamantium skeleton also houses your brain. So here's the question. If I start smashing your head against the ground as hard as I can, and your brain starts smashing against the side of your skull, what's going to happen? And he says, "Let's find out." And so he just starts smashing his head into the ground. And it's cool. It's because it's something that we've never really seen the Incredible Hulk sit down and think about before. And that's one of the reasons why the World War Hulk story works out so well, is because it's a really intelligent Incredible Hulk at the absolute peak of his strength, going against some of the most formidable heroes in the history of Marvel Comics. And so it just comes out awesome. Now from here, we pick up with the arrival of Juggernaut. Now, this is not a fully powered Kane Marco, not even by 50%. And this is shown in the fact that as soon as he arrives and he tries to go against the Hulk just takes him out immediately. I mean, he's just like, "Get out of here," down for the count. And so we basically pick up with whoever's left. I mean, we have different people like Strong Guy, we have Wolfsbane, we have Nightcrawler, Warpath. You know, we have Jimmy Madrox, we even have Darwin. And this is actually a really cool situation because Darwin is an Omega level mutant, but his mutant power is basically to allow his body to do whatever it needs to do for him to survive a situation. So he's like the extreme example of a survivalist. Now, when they arrive here, again, it's much like before. They start going through and they all start trying to take the Incredible Hulk out. Now, the cool thing is that none of them are really able to do it. I mean, Strong Guy and Warpath are the only ones that have the power to really pull this off. Darwin, with his ability to, you know, again, alter his body's structure, his body automatically altering its structure in order to ensure his survival, basically redesigns or restructures itself in a way to where he can start absorbing gamma radiation. Now, the idea here is that because the Incredible Hulk himself is powered by gamma radiation, it's essentially a scenario where he's operating much like a battery. Under normal circumstances, the Incredible Hulk can be exhausted. The Incredible Hulk's, you know, gamma radiation can be siphoned off to a point where he becomes incredibly exhausted and just reverts back to his banner form. It's happened in a multitude of times in Marvel Comics. The issue with this is that because of the fact that the Incredible Hulk is so angry, he's virtually limitless right now. There is no end to his reservoir of gamma radiation. And so as Darwin siphons it off, more just keeps coming and coming and coming. And so ultimately, there's nothing he can do here. And in fact, his body actually comes to the realization that he can't stop the Incredible Hulk. And so instead of taking on some kind of mutation, like, you know, infinite strength or something like that, instead, Darwin's body just teleports him out of there, and that's it. And it's a really funny scenario because, you know, Nightcrawler comments on this. He's like, well, I mean, if Darwin's body allows him to survive any situation and Darwin left, his body teleported him away, well, then it's obvious the only way to survive the situation is to not be here. Now, at this point, we switch over to Strong Guy. Now, Strong Guy has a long-running history in the realm of Marvel Comics. He's not new, not by any stretch of the imagination. He's been in, I guess, part of X-Factor with the second iteration after Louise Simonson and Walter Simonson left. So he's like the 90s X-Factor when they were essentially a government-sanctioned superhero team. But Strong Guy's powers are almost identical to the powers of Sebastian Shaw in the sense that Sebastian Shaw can absorb kinetic energy and then channel that energy back out in terms of physical strength. That's what Strong Guy does. And Strong Guy literally, you know, takes the punches of the Incredible Hulk and turns them on him, turns them into physical energy and punches him back. The problem with this, and this is actually kind of the weakness that Strong Guy's had for quite some time, is that he cannot absorb an infinite amount of power, right? I mean, he's not like Bishop. You know, he's not like Bishop who can absorb infinite power as long as he doesn't allow his body to overrun and as long as he just, allows that energy out as it needs to be let out. Strong Guy, if he's hit with enough power, will die. His heart will literally shut down or his body will explode. And so because of this, you know, it's this situation where they're basically saying, hey, look, man, you know, Strong Guy, we like you trying to take on the Incredible Hulk, but, you know, if you absorb too much of an impact from the Incredible Hulk, it will destroy your heart. Your heart will literally just shut down and you will die. And so again, this is really just Strong Guy being forced out of the situation more so than being successfully defeated. And so at this point, we have Nightcrawler jumping in. Now, this is the cool thing because I love Nightcrawler. I mean, as a character, in terms of character development, in terms of how he's grown over the years, Nightcrawler is awesome. You know, Kurt Wagner is one of my favorite characters in all of Marvel Comics. And our initial idea would be, well, surely we can have Nightcrawler just teleport the Incredible Hulk away. I mean, couldn't he just like teleport him to another dimension or something like that? But the issue is that the Incredible Hulk's mass is far too large. Now, that's the way it works with Nightcrawler. Nightcrawler can't teleport something like it's not like Galactus could show up on Earth and then Nightcrawler could teleport him away. Nightcrawler can only teleport things of a certain size or of a certain mass. And the Incredible Hulk is simply just too big for him. Now, in truth, the reason why Nightcrawler has this limit to his powers is just for the sake of storytelling. If Nightcrawler had an unlimited amount, or if he could teleport people of an unlimited size and ability, well, in truth, he would be like Exodus. But if he were able to do that, then anytime anybody showed up to fight the X-Men, fans would ask the question, well, why doesn't Nightcrawler just teleport him away so they don't have to worry about it? So it just allows Marvel to create some compelling stories with his character, which actually works out. I mean, in truth, this isn't really something that I would look at and say, well, that's just ridiculous. I mean, it makes sense, you know, as far as I go when it comes to reading the X-Men. But we also have a scenario where another member of Nightcrawler's team had effectively taken off to grab the Black Wing X-Men jet, the X-Jet. And what she does is she actually crashes it into the Incredible Hulk. Now, this was a two-stage plan between Nightcrawler and his teammate. And I can't remember her name for the life of me, but it's a two-part plan between the two of them. And the idea is for Nightcrawler to basically move the Incredible Hulk just slightly, just enough that it puts him in the direct path. Because again, he can't teleport him that far away. The other half is to crash the X-Men's jet directly into him for the purpose of, you know, allowing the Blackbird to explode and hopefully, you know, at the very least, incapacitating the Incredible Hulk. This doesn't happen. Like, this is not what happens. In fact, the Incredible Hulk basically just emerges from the wreckage. Now, this is when we start getting into the territory of the Juggernaut at his absolute strongest. Well, I guess Juggernaut at his absolute strongest is kind of a misnomer, but when he first showed up here, he was not fully powered. And the reason why is because the amount of energy that Juggernaut can use from Sidorak or siphon from Sidorak to give him his own durability and strength is relative to his motives. And so what we learn here is that the Juggernaut showing up here was to save, or I guess to protect his stepbrother, to protect Charles Xavier. But that was a weak reason at best because it doesn't fit into the nature of Kane Marco. It doesn't allow him to give his full self over to the power of the Crimson Gem of Sidorak. And so because of this, what he does, he basically reveals his true motive. He allows himself to fully be handed over and he says, well, my goal here is to just trash the Incredible Hulk, to prove to everybody that the Juggernaut is still the strongest being out there. And so he basically imbues the full power, or at least almost entirely the full power of Sidorak. Now, the reason why I say it's almost the entire power is because during the history of Marvel Comics, there was a storyline called The Eighth Day, which talked about the Octessens, and I've got videos on that and so on and so forth. But Juggernaut was chosen to be the avatar of Sidorak, a being from the Crimson Dimension that provides Doctor Strange with his Crimson Bands to keep people imprisoned, but also supplied Juggernaut, or I guess was the reason why Juggernaut found the Crimson Gem of Sidorak. During the Eighth Day storyline, Juggernaut was imbued with the full strength, the full power of Sidorak, which basically made Juggernaut as strong as he was ever going to be, and so he's referenced as Eighth Day Juggernaut. That's where that comes from. That version of Juggernaut was insanely strong. Not on the same level as Worldbreaker Hulk, but insanely strong. And so this version of Juggernaut basically goes against Hulk as best he can, and the Incredible Hulk recognizes, you know, again, because this is Juggernaut, because he's as strong as he is, if the Juggernaut starts moving, no one's going to be able to stop him, not even Worldbreaker Hulk. And so Worldbreaker Hulk says, okay, fine, then we'll just use your momentum against you, and literally just sends him on his way. Now, at this point, you know, with the Juggernaut running, it's really more a matter of momentum. And so as long as it takes him to get up to speed, it takes him as long, if not twice as long, to slow down, turn back around, and then head back to where he was before. And so at this point, Hulk sits down and tells Charles Xavier, look, man, like, it'll be a while before Juggernaut gets back here. And while we're waiting on him, you're going to come with me. Now, this is where the Incredible Hulk basically learns about what went on behind the scenes. This is really him learning about the events of Decimation. This is him learning about how some of the mutants have been killed since the events of House of M. And so the Incredible Hulk essentially, this is kind of a lackluster ending to the story, really, but the Incredible Hulk comes to the realization that Charles Xavier views the entire House of M event as his fault. Now, the reason why Charles Xavier says that, or why he views it as his fault, is because when the Scarlet Witch created the House of M, she had kidnapped Charles Xavier and used his telepathy to read the minds of everybody in the world and give them the life that they desired, or at least all the superheroes, and give them the lives that they desired. And so even if it was against his will, Charles Xavier was complicit in House of M. And so because of this, you know, when everything came back to normal and Charles Xavier returned, he looked at the mutant population and said, this is my fault. If the Scarlet Witch had not used my brain to read the minds of all the superheroes and initiate the House of M, the depowering of mutants never would have happened. And so the Incredible Hulk essentially sits down and says, yeah, man, that sucks for you. Like, you're already living in hell. And so as a result, he kind of takes pity on Charles Xavier. And in the end, he effectively just kind of takes off and leaves Charles Xavier to his own suffering and his own misery as a guy who feels responsible for the depowering of a multitude of mutants across the entire face of the earth. But with that being said, if you guys are new here to Comics Explained, make sure you guys hit the sub button to become part of the Rob Core. If you guys enjoyed this video, drop a like and leave a comment down below. Let me know what you guys think about World War Hulk, and I will catch you all later. Peace.